Hello everybody, my name is Denis, and here is the second part of our interesting journey of creating a trading system. In the last video we defined our goals, and today we will prepare and label our dataset. Let's go! Here I defined all my functions that I'm going to use in this video. First of all, we need to load our data. Today, I will use a small dataset, because the code is not optimized and some functions may take a really long time to run. As you can see, we have a tick data here. Data time, price, bid ask, and volume. In this video, I will use only the data from 1 year. Let's select the range and check some statistics, just to have an idea what kind of data we have. You can see here our minimum and maximum price. It's around $100. This is good, because it will be easy to calculate percentages of our profit. Also, I added one important parameter to the dataset. It's the size of the spread. Spread is difference between ask and bid price. And why spread size is important? Simple example. If we have a bid equal to 100 and ask equal to 101, our spread equals $1. And if we buy and immediately sell our security, we will always lose the spread, which is equal to 1 in this example. Here I have calculated the mean spread over all days for every second. As you can see, normally we have a spread that equals to 1 or 2 cents, but sometimes we have a little bigger spread. We can decide to do our trades only if our spread is less than 3 cents. We can see, the biggest spread occurs in the first few minutes after the market opens. For this reason, it makes sense to skip the first 10-15 minutes after the market opens when we're implementing our strategy. Now, after we have set the time period, we can try to generate labels for our model, which should predict the time move direction. How we will generate the labels? As I said in the previous video, we don't have any triggers for opening a position. Because of that, we need to generate labels for each bar based on expected return. In the last video, we defined that we want to use the window method and generate labels when price crosses the window barriers. We will set 1 to the hour labels when price goes up and crosses the top window's barrier. The -1 if price goes down and crosses the bottom window barrier. And we will set 0 if the price stays in the window. The length of our window will be equal to n bars, and the higher and the lower window barriers will be set up according to our expected return in percentage. We will slide this window over all bars, with the step equal to 1 bar. If the price goes out of the window, the first bar in the window will get the label. I hope you got my idea. Now, before generating the labels, let us define the window's parameters. The idea is pretty simple, but selecting the best window size and barrier levels is a challenge. That's where I have actually been stuck for some time, and I don't think that I have found a good solution for it. To solve this task, I am going to calculate historical volatility over the day and also historical volatility over the whole period of our data. For example, this is the price change on each tick in 1 day, in percentage. And here is the volatility of this day. Let's check the volatility over the whole period of our data. As you can see, the mean volatility is only 1.003%, which is equal to around 30 cents of our current price. Before we define our window, Let's generate volume bars from our tick data. It will be easy to calculate the length of the window using bars instead of ticks, because we will have a similar amount of volume in one bar, and it will provide us with stable conditions. To generate a volume bar, we will go through the ticks and calculate the volume. For the target volume equal to 1000, we will start accumulate the volume of each tick until it will not be greater or equal to 1000. All these ticks will represent one bar. Let's generate bars for one day. You can see that we got 179 bars in the selected day. So, that is how the price graph looks now. We can also calculate percentage change in each bar and the daily volatility using the close price. Well, I don't want to use the window equal to the whole day. To select the window length, I try to generate 100 windows with the random size and check the mean volatility in each window. This graph represents the mean volatility in the windows of different lengths. If we select, for example, the size of the window equal to 50 bars, we can expect volatility around 0.001%. This value could be useful to define our minimum expected return and calculate the size of our stop loss. Let's calculate the volume bars and random windows for the whole dataset. Here we can see our window volatility over the whole period. Now we will generate the labels. And I will define my windows with the size of 50 bars, and my expected return will be 0.003%. It's around 30 cents for the mean price. After the labeling process is finished, we will get a lot of similar labels, so-called crossing labels. We don't want to have the same labels for different events. In our case, we will leave only the labels that have the closest distance between the first bar of the window and the bar where the price crosses the window barrier. Let's check how many labels we have. Well, we have around 700 labels and they distributed fast equally. Not bad. Okay, now I will save our dataset. Actually, we will have two files. One will contain volume bar dataset, and another file will contain tick information of each bar. Who knows, maybe we'll need to use this information in our model. Well, let me stop at this point. I think it's enough for today, and if you want to have more interesting information about the data labeling, I would recommend to check the chapters 3 and 4 of the book of Marcos Lopez de Prado. Our next step will be the feature engineering and running everything with the TFX pipeline. I hope I will have time to create a new episode soon. See you in the next video. Bye!